In today's day and age, stakeholders are looking at us, looking at businesses through a different lens. And to discuss and deliberate on the role of a CFO in today's contemporary world, where performance matrices are changing, how can CFO act as a chief sustainable officer and help take business to a different level? To do this discussion, we have our esteemed panel, and I'm going to request them, who's going to be moderated by Humayun Bashir. Humayun Saab has been the ex-CEO of IBM and is an advisor and the board member on the Startup Advisory Board. The panelists are going to comprise of Mr. Hanif Idrees, who's the CFO and Company Secretary, DHL Pakistan, Bruce Garrett, who's the MD, Marsh, Mr. Helmut, who's the Managing Director of Siemens Pakistan, and Rashid Masood Alam, who's the Financial Controller. So can we have a round of applause to welcome these esteemed panelists to have this discussion? If I can request Humayun Saab to lead the discussion.
From Nadeem Saab, very eloquently put together the entire agenda and the objectives of the program. We heard from Jorhum, who set the stage for the day's session. I have the pleasure of moderating this session. I have experts with me. The beauty is that we have two chief executives and two CFOs to deliberate on the subject. If we look at what is happening around us, the disruptive changes, the economic changes, the opportunities, and we look at our role, what is the role of the CFO today, what was the role of the CFO 5, 10, 15 years ago, and what is expected in the next decade. I think by the end of this session, you should have, with the help of the expert panel here, a better insight of what is needed. Now, in terms of changes that are coming, CFOs need to embrace a long-term view. They need to be the integrator. In the past, they were more about, in 10, 15 years ago, about bookkeeping, about accounting, about forecasting. In the present days, most CFOs here, and I see a lot of younger lot in their 30s here, who have a good runway of 20, 30 years ahead, inshallah, and they will see lots of changes and lot of disruptive actions about around them. We have seen many of these mentioned in Jose's presentation, in Nadeem Saab's introduction, as well as you are facing it yourself. I mean, the telecom companies are losing revenue to WhatsApp, their SMS revenue is gone, the banking companies are losing their business, the remittance and mobile payment businesses to the telecom companies. So adjacent industries are coming in. So the CFO of the future has to step out of a simple role of being an accountant or supporting the chief executive. He has to be the chief sustainability or chief performance officer, and he has an external role as well to manage the metrics and the stakeholders, external, to have a communication capability and to keep an eye on the competition and keep an eye on the challenges that are there. So let me not do all the talking. Refer to the help of some of the experts here, and may I start with Bruce. I had the pleasure of interacting with all the four participants over the last 3 days. We spent 10-15 minutes on phone exchanging notes, etc., so that we are on a common wavelength. So Bruce, can you walk us through your views? You have spent a lot of time in Pakistan and Dubai and other places. How do you see the role of a CFO changing in the coming 10 years, and what do these young people need to prepare for?
Well, I think my overview is going to be from a relatively simplistic perspective. I think that we, in whatever industry we work, are faced now with challenges, many of which we haven't anticipated. The competitive environment, it doesn't matter which business you're in a very competitive environment. And from a CFO's perspective, I think, you know, somebody as old as I has always been slightly pejorative about the accountants and the finance function. It's been about producing financial data, making sure that the reporting has been done correctly and accurately, and avoiding too many nasty questions being asked. And it's very clear to me, because I discussed with Humayun last night, we are both grandfathers. And so we understand the challenges of having significantly younger children who are pushing the boundaries in every possible direction. And they are much more concerned about sustainability than our generation. I can just give you a little anecdote. This morning I received from my youngest daughter-in-law a whole lot of information about her concerns about the sustainable world in which she is now living. And it was very interesting to read an article when I was able to access the internet. So we may be going to, José, make a lot of progress very quickly, but you can't always access the internet even when you know that you have got free access. But when I was able to access the internet, the message that came through was that Unilever have been looking at changing the products that they have been selling and making them more sustainable. And actually it was fantastic to read that they reckon that for the sustainable products that they make, and they advertise them as sustainable, they've actually seen growth in their numbers in 2015 of 30%. So, what are the challenges for a CFO? First of all, you've got to be good at doing what I would call the basic job. But actually, as the CFO, you're probably not going to be doing so much of the number crunching as you might have been used to doing in the past. What you've got to be able to do, I think, is to look inside your business. You've got to have very good skills at networking and getting on well with the drivers of the different business units if you're in a multifaceted organization. So you've got to understand, know, appreciate, and really have the respect of your colleagues. So that's a job internally. You've got to be motivating the younger people who are working for you. You've got to keep them motivated, because the biggest challenge in the world today is that as soon as anybody comes out of a university with a degree or a doctorate or an MBA, they want to be the CEO. And realistically, you can't get to that sort of position until you've had just a little bit more of what one might describe as real commercial experience. Because being out there in the real world, rather than being in the academic and student world, is a very different experience. So you've got to be a multifaceted and a multi-skilled person. You cannot just be, you know, a one-size-fits-all person. And so I think that the challenges are enormous. It's going to require significantly broader vision, both inside the company and also outside the company. It's going to be requiring significant networking skills. It's going to require significant interpersonal skills as well. And of course, a very large brain. I have a very small brain, so it's nice and easy. I don't stretch myself too hard. Those are my initial thoughts.
Great, lovely. So, multifaceted skills, networking, communication skills. Some of these skills are not that easy to gather, and usually are not in the as part of the roadmap of a chartered accountant or a entry-level CFO in the initial years. But as we go along, these will become more and more important, how we put it all together. So, as Nadeem Saab said it, we need to, our CFOs need to future-proof the organization. Let me turn to a CFO, very, very experienced person sitting next to me, Mr. Idrees Saab, and get his views on the subject. From a CFO perspective, how does he see the role of the CFO in evolving?
Thank you, Humayun. If you see the role of CFO, you have to see how it is transformed. In 1960s and 70s, it was purely a bookkeeping role, number crunching. And gradually, what events happened internationally, the first of all, globalization. Globalization brought it with itself a lot of challenges. The global initiatives have to be successful. And we have seen that CFOs have played a very important role in making those global initiatives successful. I will give you an example of Starbucks. Starbucks, when it started, it had less than 200 stores in 1992. In 2013, it had more than 19,000 stores. And if you see the story of Starbucks, the key role was played by their CFO. So first thing was the globalization, which really impacted a lot on the CFO's role. The second thing which happened was the rapid technological progress, especially the information technology. A lot of information is available, and every time the scenarios are changing. There are more choices for the customers, there are more choices for your employees. So attracting and retaining the talent became very important. Attracting and retaining your customers became very important. And the CEOs and the business heads are always faced with the problem that how to assess the opportunities. And CFO has to come there, and he had to assist the CEOs, not with the historical information, but with the futuristic information. So that became very important, because whatever is done, that is history. So accountant had to come out of his role of historian and more of future teller. Another thing which happened is the economic situation, world order, you can see. We saw polarization, we are experiencing Brexit, the oil prices we have seen. Those businesses which were planning or which were forecasting that there will be an entry barrier because of the high oil prices, the transportation cost has gone down and the access has become easier. Another thing which happened, if you see the events of 2001 to 2010, what has happened is that there was an old saying that turnover is vanity and profit is sanity. That old saying was abundant, and there was a lot of desire for growth and inflating the bottom lines. And in that desire, we saw that there were a lot of undesirable practices, off-balance sheet liabilities, leading to high-profile corporate scandals. And that was a backlash on the role of the accountants. And I think so CFOs in last few years have been spending their time in repairing that damage. Okay, so that was a sort of, I see that as a role, as an impediment in the growth role which CFOs were embarking upon. And I think so we have come over that now. The regulatory framework has become very stringent. So CFOs have to be very cognizant with the business. They have to come out of the back role, behind the numbers. They have to come on the front. And front to such an extent that they have to interact with the customers. They need to see what is required for the business. Because if you analyze the role of CFOs, I see there are four key roles. One is the stewardship, one is the operator, and one is the strategist, and fourth is the catalyst. So in the current era, I think so CFOs are focusing more on being a strategist or catalyst. And when we say strategist, they have to bring financial leadership to align the financial strategies with the business strategy. And as a catalyst, they have to be a preacher, a promoter within the organization. And for that, they need strong negotiation skills. They need strong communication skills within the organization and outside the organization. So they have to keep their ears on the ground, very close to the business, and not in the back office, busy with the numbers. The technological progress has helped a lot. That a lot of mundane tasks of the accountants has been taken over by ERPs and the systems. So this is my views on that.
Great. So basically, to sum it up, some space has been created with the automation and the technologies and the ERPs, and with the handling of the issues that were in the last decade. So there are better systems in place today, better controls and better processes. And the CFO is required now to step out of his comfort zone and address the catalyst and the change maker role that is required. So let me turn to another chief executive, Helmut from Siemens. Siemens has been operating in Pakistan for decades now, and like to know from your experience on this subject, how do you view your CFO? What would you like to see?
Humayun, thank you very much. A lot has been said already from my two colleagues here. We are a company that is operating since 170 years. Siemens is 170 years old. In Pakistan, we started with our first office in 1922. I have quite a number of years with this organization. And one of the learnings that I took was that, first of all, it depends heavily on the relationship that you have together. The CFO is a business partner of the CEO. There needs to be 100% trust. If the trust is not there, forget it. You will drive the company onto the wall. And you have seen examples where this has happened, and which was a disaster for the organization. So I think the first important thing is build up the trust and make sure that you have trust and you trust each other. Because the moment that you trust each other, you're open. You're transparent. You discuss topics which you can also then disagree upon, which is important to drive the company forward, especially in these times that we are facing now. The second thing within, let's say, the experience that I made is we have a robust system where the culture of the commercial counterpart is ingrained in our day-to-day activities. So be it sales, be it operations, in other areas, we have a commercial counterpart working very closely together with the technical team. And this is also enabling the commercial organization to embed themselves in the day-to-day operational activities. They get used to the idea of selling to a customer. They don't shy away of going out to meet customers and interact with customers. They look across the area of their own core responsibility and get the knowledge that they need to drive also further, and then later on take over the responsibility of a CEO. I mean, our organization, Joe Kayser, who is now the CEO, he used to be the CFO. He was very strong. He has a long history with the company. He has been in strategy, in sales, in and he was not always bound to the accounting side, which is crucial because the books and records is the most important topic. Yeah, you need to trust, again, coming back to the trust topic. So, so far, as I said, I mean, I came across good and bad examples. I enjoy a very good relationship with my current counterpart, which is good because this is something that you need in order to stabilize an organization and bring the message also to your team. And with this, I'm also sure that together we can address the challenges that are lying ahead, as you quite rightly pointed out. The challenges that you have in the market, the challenges that you have in certain government activities that are happening, regulatory activities that you need to address. It's a fascinating responsibility that you have.
Great. I think the word trust came about a couple of times, and it is key. It is really key in the relationship at the C level, at the C-suite level. The CFO and the CEO is like a team. They need to mirror each other. The CFO should be the sounding board for the crazy ideas of the CEO or even the board. The CFO has a view of the entire organization. Not only the financial metrics, he's looking at the metrics of the marketing, of the production, of the shop floor, supply chain, and so on. And he needs to mesh them all together. And that is the new challenge that is coming up. Let me turn to Rashid, right? So he corrected me. His name is not Rashid, it's Rashid, although he spells that Rashid. Rashid, walk us through. I know a lot has been already been said, but anything you would like to add to this before I open a new round of questions?
Humayun Saab, the dilemma with the VL, the accountant phase, that when we started our studies, we were told that accountant or the auditors, we are conservative. The first lesson, which a textbook in our accountancy, that teaches us that, say, we, being an accountant, are conservative. We have to book the cost immediately if there's a likelihood even, and we can't book the revenue immediately.
Right.
So basically, coming from that background, if you ask me the role of CFO vis-a-vis CEO, vis-a-vis society, and as a chief performing officer, so I must tell you that the CFO or the financial controller or anybody in the finance, I mean, they always come up with a different responsibility. You never heard of any auditor being given a different title. You never heard of a director marketing being given a different title or a new responsibility other than marketing. You've never heard of a sales director or the sales in charge of a company being vested with a new title, new responsibility. It's always a CFO who is always a value enhancer. He is always the chief integrity officer of a company. He is always the chief performance officer of the company. So much so that I've always seen this profession or this responsibility going up and being added and going up and up on the ladder. So basically there's two things. One thing is that the CFO occupies a very neutral position in a company. He doesn't have any business interest. Let's suppose that if he sides with the marketing guy, or if he says something, or if he sides with the chief executive, stuff like that. So that is a quite a unique position of a CFO, which he enjoys in a company. The second thing is that, I'll just talk of the topic, being a performance officer. So being a chief performance officer, it's a must for a CFO to look for the value drivers, which is quite a technical job basically. And CFOs are usually not trained for this job. Linking between the financial and non-financial information, looking for the value drivers, which itself is quite a complex thing. So basically there is a need for constant evolution of CFO, which is definitely, this role is being evolved, but side by side, capacity and capability building as well. Because if something wrong happens in a company, sabse patli gardiyan CFO ki hoti hai, ya audit pe baithe hue logon ki hoti hai, ke yaar aapne nahi dekha, ya aapne ye cheez nahi pakdi, and this is very strange. Nobody held responsible to the director marketing or director sales ke ji, inke number galat aa rahe the. So basically, CFO ka role, agar hum performance pe dekhte hain, to we are just changing him into a chief data officer sort of thing. You see, there is a strong criticism that if you are evolving the role of the CFO, evolve towards some more, you see, progressive thing, maybe the chief valuation officer as well. But when you talk of the chief performing officer, capturing data from all the department concerned, putting it in the right manner, evolving it, there may be director sales might, you know, come today in a meeting with all furious action that what the hell CFO knows about my figures, my business. He should only be concerned with the, you know, financial numbers. And how could I give the mantle, or how could that CFO be the custodian of the number of sales which he does not know anything about? How could that be possible? So that criticism, that is quite, you know, valid at certain point. Unless you enhance the capability of CFOs, unless you make him, I mean, you know, more capable of embracing with the whole situation, otherwise there has always been a demand for the CFOs that should understand the integrity, they should understand the value creation, they should, but in my view, basically, I mean, they are the best integrator.
Right.
Right? They take all numbers, financial and non-financial, operations, sales, marketing, and they mix it, they put it in such a fashion, they tabulate it in such a matrix form, whereby the accountability and things are quite easy. But he is not the one who is the judge. He is not the one who will make other people accountable before him or before anybody else. Rather, there should be a more powerful forum in the organization, like some sort of a management committee. Right. There should be a specific TORs for the, you know, looking into the performance metrics and interpreting them. So
good, good. Thank you. So we have a different perspective here. Rashid is feeling the and sensing the pressure of the multiple layers of responsibilities that are being put on the shoulders of the CFO. And many of the CFOs of the future need to be groomed and trained to build these new skills, because this doesn't come naturally to them. And some of them may be uncomfortable in these areas. So, thank you, Rashid, for very, very insightful input. So, can I get the input of the panel on what can be done? Of course, the CFO and the board and other committees need to empower the CFO, to give CFO the mantle in the C-suite, in the management committee. But again, the CFO needs a development and being accepted as a model there. But would any one of you like to comment on what kind of help can be given in terms of training, in terms of special assignments and grooming? So any one of you would like to comment on that?
I can give an example. I mean, for what we are doing is we have so-called 4I principles. So the commercial colleagues are always together with the technical colleagues going through processes, procedures. They get experience. They are get exposed to all different types of trainings and interactions with different layers of the organization, so they get exposed. But what is, and I think it was mentioned before, what is important is to take also the willingness to expose yourself. Yeah. Get also toward a project site. Go out there and see how is the health and safety situation on a project site, to get an idea what is happening there, because this is something which normally is not on the radar screen in such a level from a commercial point of view, from a CFO point of view. But all of a sudden, this will really increase the experience and the learnings that you can do. Okay. And it also showcases to the team that you take the whole matter of the organization responsibly.
Right. So I've got a love letter. No, I understand we are sitting between lunch and you. Any other comment?
I would like to add to this that no formal training can bring this revolution in the CFO. What is required is the CFOs have to take initiative and they have to get closer to the business. If they are in the back office, they will never get this role. So no one can come and train you to do this. Yeah, an enabling environment can be created. That is what CEOs and board can do. But CFOs have to take the initiative. If they remain shy away from the business, if they remain away from the customers, then nothing is going to happen. So it is a CFO's initiative. I can give you an example in DHL. We have joint visits with the commercial team and the finance team to the customers. And then we come and brainstorm that thing and then we create solutions. So CFOs have to lead the solutions. If they are solution providers, people will embrace them, people will listen to them. So it's basically actively listening to your customers, actively listening to the stakeholders, and then coming up with innovative solutions. Because in today's age, technology is rampant. So you have to pick up the relevant things. If you load too much your colleagues with the details, then no one is going to listen to you. So analysis should not become paralysis. The relevant analysis is very important. And the initiative and the burden comes on the CFO. He has to take the initiative.
Great.
Like to add one thing. I would fully agree with what Hanif said, that we should be the strategic partner of the business instead of, you know, from backbenches just used to criticize things on the business that, okay, they are not doing this, they are not doing that. In order to understand the market sentiments, the customer's preference, we have to have our hands on the pulse of the market. We should know. I mean, if there's the emergence of social media and there's a much talked about word disruption, I mean, at least 70 times that the word has been repeated over here on this forum.
Absolutely.
I must say. So, yeah, we should be cognizant of the fact that what is new, how other medias are working, what could be the value driver, let's suppose, for a social media marketing type of thing, what could be the value driver of the, you know, customers' preferences, how customers' preferences are changing, as we have seen from taxi to Uber and BNN and stuff like that. So I would fully agree. and that should be the name of the game, that the CFO should be the strategic partner of the business. But yes, capacity building and the capacity enhancement should always be made integral part by the board, by the management and
everything. Thank you. During my 16 years as CEO with IBM, I retired in July after 40 years with IBM. I had four CFOs, and the first one was way ahead of the future. So he was my partner, he was my business partner, he was my driver, and so he was must have been too good because he's the governor of Sindh right now. All right, and then I had a CFO who was young. And was not ready, so we sent him to our headquarters in Vienna, and we spent some time there managing Central and Eastern Europe and getting bigger exposure in a bigger pond. So, you know, what we can do is to give some experiences, if not external, then within the organization, to put the CFO on some special projects, some committees. To work with other C-level or other departments, and some of his skills will develop if the organization does not have possibility of rotations, etc. So these are some of the capabilities. Now we are required to end in 5 minutes, but I would want a quick question. CFO as the future CEO. I've seen many successful CFOs turn CEOs. So any opinions? I mean, a 30 second or 1 minute input from some of you.
There are some CEOs who are in this room, I think, who have been CFOs. So it's perfectly possible to be achieved. And I think the important thing is to, if you have ambition, you should make it very clear that you have ambition. Not everybody has ambition. And if you want to grow, you have to push the boundaries. And there are many companies that I've met here in Pakistan that, for me, are managing their people extremely well. I would make the comment that I don't think all multinational companies manage their people as well as, for example, Siemens and IBM. And one final comment, if you are a good CFO now, you should already know who your successor is, because that's the next big challenge. You have got to know who's going to step into your shoes and do the job better and differently.
Any other comment?
I think one of the other things to remember is the CFO, and I think it was mentioned earlier, is always a bit cautious. When you become the CEO, you need to be optimistic, and that is something that that is important without losing the overview. But you need to distribute also a certain level of optimism.
Okay.
Yeah, I would completely agree with that. That being after CFO and working on this position for a while, one is ready to prepare to to accept this challenge. But a few personality traits, like one should be always optimistic, forthcoming, not to be extroverted all the time, should meet people, discuss things, new challenges, present things.
So,
ये सारी चीजें अगर हों तो I don't think इसके अलावा ये कि थोड़ी सी किस्मत हो आपके साथ तो
मेरा ख्याल है कि parents prayers are always
exactly माँ की दुआ और जन्नत की हवा.
Yes, absolutely.
I think CFOs have to increase the risk appetite. That is, they cannot remain conservative if they want to go and step up at a higher position. So it's basically they have to enhance their risk appetite and use their financial knowledge as a tool, because a person who is not been a CFO, he's bound to take a blind risk. Whereas a CFO can take a risk-adjusted, create a risk-adjusted financial information and take a calculated risk. So I think the CFO is more better positioned to take the CEO position with his financial knowledge. It is just taking a different approach towards risk taking and towards interpersonal skills. Basically, human resource is very important. So CFOs have to focus on creating credible teams so that there are people to take care and they have enough time to have crazy thoughts like CEO and then evaluate them and make a risk adjusted information for the success of the business.
Thank you. So what I see in the audience is several future CEOs in the making. You have to do succession planning as a first step, and build new skills if you have to move on. So I think there were several nuggets some new things that I learned as well, and I hope it was useful for you. The word of risk appetite. So when you talk of appetite, you talk of lunch, and we need to break soon. I don't know if we have time for a couple of questions. Khurram, ijazat hai ya? One or two questions, if there are any questions, the people.
Questions?
Please, here.
From the audience.
Questions from the audience here. In the third row, please. Mic to the third row, please.
My name is Junaid Shekhar. Obviously, I've seen many people, many CFOs who have got that kind of ambition to rise to the position of CEOs. This is, their right to be the CEO. But how in a large organization, what kind of support from the other teams, let's say from the business, from the operations, what kind of support do the CFOs actually get in getting their promotion to the level of CEO? Are there any obstacles? Is there a real kind of support? Your views, please.
Would anybody like to take?
The obstacle for a CFO to get to the position of CEO is possibly more than likely it's going to be made up of the people that he or she has been working with, because to be the CEO of an organization, you are ultimately the guy that. As to the capabilities, and I honestly don't know how often companies really do look at their personnel in certain positions and assess whether they really do have the potential to go to the next level. I talked about young people being incredibly ambitious. That's perfectly correct. That's perfectly right, because the world is driven by young people. Many of the countries of this world have many people that are aged under 35, and there are fewer and fewer. There are increasing aging populations, but it is the young people that are going to drive the position forward. So age should not be a barrier to success or promotion, but you have got to be given the opportunity by your employer to have a variety of experiences. You cannot move up the ladder unless you have been tested in a number of different situations. Those are my comments.
No, I absolutely agree. And there are a couple of, I'm not only talking about now Siemens as an example, we have a number of CFOs that have become CEOs, but also let's say, for example, just the latest news in Germany, the state-owned Deutsche Bahn railway operators, they have announced and the board has selected the CFO to become the new CEO. So he was acting CEO for some time. And he has, because they trusted in his detailed knowledge also of the company and his engagement on the day-to-day operational level also to run the company in the future as well. 300,000 people, 40 billion euros worth of turnover.
Okay. Right. Thank you very much. I thank the panelists. Please give them a round of applause. I thank the audience for patiently sitting through and controlling their appetite. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Humayun, Bashir, Mr. Hanif, Idrees, Bruce Garrett, Mr. Helmut, and Rashid Masood Saab. Thank you so much sharing your insights, and I'm sure every one of us learned something out of the session. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.